deficit of 5.2431, and 457,911 favorable year to date. I've also passed out a spreadsheet called PTAB inventory. What this reflects is the PTAB, I guess you'd call them suits, that we're getting, or requests for reviews of assessed valuation. This particular one is from Coca-Cola, and could impact us by $12,340.89 for 1 year if they prevail, or $37,022.68 would be the 3 year impact. Probably won't be that amount, probably be a lesser amount, but we won't know until they settle.
Any idea of how long we've been
waiting
for that?
Well, we just, a few meetings ago, talked about the Coca-Cola 2010 reduction. And this, you know,
so it could be forever.
It takes a while.
Yeah, okay.
But we are not sending this to Michael.
Yeah.
We're just assuming that the other
people, the other partners, like the school districts and things like
that, will be right there. Just,
yeah,
take
a
look,
do sometimes. Okay, that's good.
You can't.
Well, just sort of writing a quick note for taxing bodies and letting them pay the break. Well, if you don't want to do it that
way, you certainly can give us instruction to handle it differently.
So what I plan to do is, as this changes, I'll hand out updated copies just so you're aware of what's going on with the property taxes.
Okay, any discussion?
I actually have a question. Now that we went through it, on page 14 of the income statement, I had two questions. The total workers' compensation expenditures, is that a one-time payment?
Yes.
Okay, so that's not what I thought. And down a little bit lower, under the building and equipment maintenance, we have a non-contractual maintenance that we had budgeted $15,000 and we're already $15,300. Are we like
looking to be way over budget on that as the year goes by?
We had some residual issues from a power outage. That caused some issues with the heating equipment. Primarily, not the boilers. The boilers are brand new, but the distribution, the air distribution. Yeah. So we had to address that, and comes up when it comes up.
Sure.
Yeah, it's $2,000 or $3,000 here and there. Yes, we're trying to keep the building warm and keep the pipes open.
Okay. So it's not much we can do about it.
No, it's not something that was a luxury by any stretch of the imagination.
Okie doke. Okay, thank you.
All right, thank you, Greg. I will now entertain a motion to approve the payment of bills for operating expenses. $224,779.58. Payroll expenses of $254,952.41. And a special reserve expenses of $6,617.40. For a total monthly expense of $486,349.39.
So moved.
Second. And Karen. Okay, any discussion? All right, Diana, please take a roll starting here.
Barbara?
Yes.
Rob?
Yes.
Kim?
Yes.
Carolyn?
Yes.
Patty?
Yes.
Linda?
Yes.
Karen?
Yes.
Okay, next item on the agenda, director's report.
Okay, I want to keep it short so we can keep moving here, so I just have three items. The deadline for the per capita grant,
application, which is usually in October, is now coming due in January 15th. What I'm planning to do with that this year is, that's the thing where we get a certain number of cents per person in the district. And this last year it was about 75 cents per person, the year before that it was $1.25. So we really don't ever know what we're going to get, so I like to make it a sort of things that we could live without them if they decided not to give us any money at all. So what I did this last year and what I'd like to do next year is to divide it into roughly three pots of money, one for purchasing technology supplies like the filament for the 3D printers, any other kind of things that are consumable. I would like to put another third of it toward having the selectors write an application to say they need to build up their collection in particular areas, which they've been doing. For example, we're buying some additional graphic novels for kids because that collection needed updating. And the third bucket is for them, for the department heads in particular, if there are any temporary, if they need temporary workers to handle projects or to handle particular busy periods, to put in an application for that. So that's how I'm planning on spending the money again next year, but there's still time to change that if anybody has ideas that they want me to consider. So just putting that out there in case anybody wants to think about it and get back to me. The next thing I wanted to talk about is strategic planning. We have had an update from the consultants, KBA, giving us preliminary results on some of the focus group material, and they'll be compiling that for the packets for the retreat. The retreat, please do get on your schedules, is January 16th, Martin Luther King Day, 10 o'clock, and I just booked Amici for that today, the private room of Amici. So we'll be there, it'll run roughly 10 to 4. Yeah.
Oh, okay. So that's January
16th.
Okay.
It's a Monday.
I'll have to keep that in mind because my cohort is already planning things for, well,
Yeah.
And you say it will run 10 to what?
Roughly 10 to 4.
Okay.
I think they try to do it a little bit faster than that.
That's
my
promise.
I know.
Oh, okay.
But because some people give permission to do stuff during school and we don't, we figured we do stuff on non-school days.
All right. And then the last piece of information is just that this is the week where people that are want to run for trustee can submit their petitions, and we have three candidates so far.
Who are the three candidates?
Three candidates are Mr. Bright, Mr. Martin, and a school librarian named Diane Olson.
What school is she from? Will we come out in our area here?
Yeah.
Yeah, she out in the...
No, she's...
No.
She's
Emerson.
Oh, okay. I thought maybe you got someone from the north end.
Okay.
No.
Cool. Okay, that's all I have. If anybody has any questions for me?
So I see on page 26 that you guys are using those sleeves, the CDs.
We're going to experiment with that.
Yeah.
Yes.
See? ALA conference, money well spent.
Yep.
All right, good.
Yes, we're going to try it out on the young adult collection because it's a small collection and that'll give us a feel for whether there's more breakage and things like that.
That's great.
I just wanted to highlight, because I know one of our goals is to up our district cardholders, and highlight on page 29 that it looks like it's, oh no, is it lower than the last
year? Yeah, it looks like
oh,
it's
lower. I kind of read that wrong.
Yeah,
so
it looks like it slipped a little for that.
So, no, well,
yeah.
Well, I thought it was a positive, but I guess it's not
good. Yeah.
I'm reading it left to right instead of right to left.
Oh, yes, we're still working on that. And then I also do want to point out in the statistics that I just want to remind you that because we started auto-renewal, that is part of the reason why all of our circulation figures are increasing. So that means that will
yes.
flatten out of them eventually.
Yes.
So don't think that that
yes.
means something terrible has happened when it starts to flatten out.
Yes.
Right now we're still enjoying the rise.
And I think I had a question on that because I took one of those hot spots out.
Mm-hmm.
That doesn't
that,
auto.
That I think is, does not auto.
Okay, that doesn't auto
right
now.
Right.
Okay, so it's, well, print.
It's
print.
Right, the DVDs and things like that, yeah.
Okay, gotcha. Communications. Committee reports. Building and meeting sometime in January. We tried to set one up, but people weren't able to make the dates.
All right, next on the agenda is the liaison report, Council Library, Carolyn.
There was a meeting, but there was a breakfast, and unfortunately, I wasn't able to make the luncheon, though.
Yeah.
So that would have been the scoop. So if anyone attended, I think the volunteers were also invited. Were you able to?
Yeah, I was there, and there were three volunteers there. Total of 14. It was very nice at the Lone Tree.
Oh. Oh, thank you.
Okay, legislative. Rails.
Yep.
Okay, secretary's report. For the certified copy of ordinance.
So I'm going to read that.
Look at this page.
Oh, it's actually on the agenda page?
The bottom of the first agenda page.
Okay, thank you. A certified copy of ordinance 1607, an ordinance levying and assessing taxes of the Niles Public Library District, Cook County, Illinois, for the fiscal year beginning July 1st, 2016, and ending June 30th, 2017, along with a certified copy of a truth in taxation certificate of compliance, was mailed to the Cook County Clerk on November 21st, 2016.
Thank you. Then under new business, I hear a motion to approve resolution 16-03 to make additional employer contributions, which transfers $2 million to the Illinois Municipal Retirement Fund.
So moved.
Second.
Kitty? Okay, Greg, we voted on this last month, but now we need a resolution.
So after last month's meeting, I contacted the IMRF to make arrangements to transfer money to them, and they said we needed a resolution. And as speaking to the same person that I spoke to beforehand, as we were drafting the, as we were drafting the analysis and so forth, and he never made mention of the resolution. So he sent me a resolution. Nothing has changed except it's on the form that they required.
Any discussion?
I have a question. So we're approving a resolution for $2 million, but we actually need $2 million for. How does that? I don't understand how we cover all of what we need for IMRF. Or do you not need to provide them with all of that money?
We don't need to provide them with all of the money. The $2 million for that you're referring to is the sum total of all past service costs that would be due from the employees. The total as of today, to the best of our ability to calculate, is probably about $1.6 million after you above and beyond the $858,000 related to the 20% that is given to the employees to start the number vesting schedule. So when you add those two numbers together, coincidentally, it's about $2 million. But this $2 million you're referring to is a different number.
Okay, what are we paying $2 million then if we're not covering this?
It will reduce the unfunded liability by $2 million.
Okay, and the unfunded liability consists of what?
So when an employee works an hour, there's something called normal costs that they collect in order to fund the pension related to that hour of work. Related to past, you have normal costs related to past service costs, but it's a much larger number.
Right.
Because it's an aggregation of 10 years,
right.
15 years, 20 years. And if nobody bought any of their past service, our unfunded liability associated with the 20% that each employee received would be $858,993. If they bought all of their past service, that number goes up to $3,661,151.
Mm-hmm.
We're estimating that it'll be somewhere in the 2.3-2.4 range, because in order to nail this number, you actually need a full actuarial assessment. And that
another one?
Well, every year there's an actuarial assessment.
Okay, right now for this year, last month, we talked about an underfunded amount, and it had two components. One was the initial 20%, which was $858,000. Then there was a cost of all the employees who were buying back previous years of service. Mm-hmm. So that came to $2 million something.
Mm-hmm.
So now is there a third component, an unfunded cost, which has to do with the hourly rate that they work, that you just mentioned?
No, that's the normal cost is what's paid on an ongoing basis through the 8.12%.
So that's our monthly
payment
to them.
Yeah.
But in order to raise, in order to provide them $2 million, or the reason we're providing them $2 million is, I thought, to cover past service and the initial $800,000. Is that not correct?
It'll cover $2 million of the
of
roughly $2.5 million, yeah.
Okay, and are we expecting the 57%, which is left of past service, to be purchased?
I couldn't tell you.
What are the parameters?
It depends on each individual's desire for security through IMRF and retirement, whether or not they have the funds available,
mm-hmm.
And a number of other factors, whether they believe they're going to live a long time and to be able to take advantage of it, and so forth. So the only way to figure out, you know, what everybody is going to do is to sit them down and ask them. You know,
so IMRF isn't aware of all the years of service that could possibly be bought?
They are aware of it.
Okay, so could we just get that figure from them just so we have an idea of what the total package would cost us? Because I guess what I'm surprised at is there isn't a deadline to purchase your previous years of service.
Yeah.
They could determine to do that anytime during their employment.
Up until the last day of their appointment.
Okay, so in the next 10 years, they could still buy back this 57%.
Yeah, it could, but I think it, as time goes by, people are less likely to do that because the cost to buy it back goes up every year. So if you're going to do it, it seems like you would do it right away.
And that's possible. So how can we find out what this 57% represents? I mean, couldn't IMRF tell us that? We know that 43% equals $2,497,000. So where would we... could we find out what that 57% is? Because, you
isn't
know, after New Year's, people may have...
Isn't that the total, the 3.6?
I don't know. Is that the total? 57% buyback would be...
if all past service is purchased.
Less than 43%? No, that doesn't make sense.
At the time that I wrote this, we had total commitment and actual transfers that amounted to 1076952.08. That number as a percentage of the total was 43%.
Okay.
The difference between the total of roughly 2.5 million, you know, 2,497,562.89, and the amount that has already had been purchased at this rating.
Okay.
The difference between those two is roughly $1,000,004.
So
that's
right now we're at $1,400,000.
Right. That
okay.
I mean, at this, excuse me,
sure,
at
sure.
this writing,
mm-hmm.
which is at least 30 days old.
Okay.
Okay. Most currently, okay, as of today, there's there's roughly $1.3 million that has been purchased. Okay, so it's gone up a little bit.
Okay, and so every
and that $1.3 million represents roughly, you know, $1.5 million in unfunded liability increase.
So $1.3 million that they purchased cost us $1.5 million. So
right.
Not dollar for dollar. Okay.
But, yeah, I mean we are. So let's talk about normal cost again. So when you work an hour, you have to pay, we have to pay 5.13%, okay, of that wage.
Right.
What the employee pays is 4.5%. So our match is a little bit more than 100%, just for the service cost.
Okay, because I think you're including that. I see what you're saying.
Okay.
But then as far as thinking that the total of all the past service is $3,661,000, is that correct? Because I'm thinking if we would subtract the $1,003,000 from that, are we saying we're not at 43%? We're higher now?
We're higher now.
Okay, so let me just rephrase his question. Is 3.6 the total it would cost us if everyone in the library bought back 30 years of service?
That's correct.
That is? So we did get that number from IMRF?
That's correct.
And the difference between this 1.3 and 3.3 million 600 is something that can happen over the years of their service.
Sure.
Okay, well that answers my question.
Can I clarify what I remember from this situation? Didn't we decide on the 2 million because where it's at right now is very extremely low interest that it's earning, and that we would wind up being ahead of the game by putting it in IMRF because it would lower our interest rate that we could potentially owe them?
Well, not the interest rate, but the interest cost associated with the unfunded liability. So the unfunded liability is like a mortgage.
Mm-hmm.
And we pay that off, a portion of our monthly payments go to retire debt.
Mm-hmm.
And the interest rate that they use is 7.5%.
Mm-hmm.
So if you look at the $2 million just by itself, and we pay $2 million, we're basically avoiding 7.5% on $2 million of unfunded liability.
Mm-hmm.
So it's like if you have a mortgage on your house and you got a bonus at work, let's say, or you sold the property, or you had a windfall maybe from an inheritance of $100,000, mm-hmm. and you paid that against your mortgage, you would avoid interest on that mortgage, on that amount,
mm-hmm.
for paying down that mortgage for all the years that that mortgage is open.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Any other questions?
I just have one clarification. So once you pay the $2 million, we will be still paying our monthly fee to them of some, what, $16,000, is it? So
yeah, it's about $18,000.
So that will that will still continue. This
yeah.
$2 million doesn't only. Okay, thank you.
Okay. All right, Diane, please take a roll.
Barbara?
Yes.
Ron?
Yes.
Tim?
Yes.
Carolyn?
No.
Patty?
Yes.
Linda?
Yes.
Karen?
Yes.
Okay. I will now hear a motion to approve the expenditure not to exceed $8,500 to hire VireTech to assist information technology services with the implementation and migration of the library district's Exchange server to the cloud.
So
motion.
Moved.
Karen?
Second.
Second. Herb? So what do we need to know about this? Mr. Gray?
Okay. So currently, we have a large server here on premises. We call it our Exchange server. It's basically the backbone for Outlook and other communication services. What we've decided to do as a result of our work with Peters Associates a couple of years ago, or maybe a year ago at this point, and their review of all of our systems, and what their recommendation was to take advantage of the new architecture that Microsoft is offering, and basically take this server and put it up in the cloud. And that does a couple of things. You know, one thing it'll do is it'll take us out of the equipment business. We'll no longer have to buy servers to support Microsoft Exchange, because it'll be in the cloud. We'll pay a subscription fee, a per user subscription fee, and that cost will actually be embedded in that fee. So when the servers wear out, when it's time to replace the servers, we won't have to source them, we won't have to worry anything about them. All we have to worry about is whether or not we're getting the service. And this is part of the overall strategy to move more of our resources to the cloud just for that very reason, so that we could depend on Microsoft's expertise in terms of running a data center, and we could focus on the delivery of services to the desktop.
Thanks. I have a question. So you're are we only assuming that moving our server to the cloud is going to save us on servers and maintenance? I thought some time ago our plan was to move much to the cloud, and we were going to save.
You do it a step at a time.
So it's in increments that we'll be moving things. And then, do we know what our per user subscription fee is? How that's considered?
I don't have that.
Do you know about how much it is? Is it a monthly fee? A yearly fee?
It is a monthly fee.
10,000.
Oh, no, it's not that high. I don't have anything. I'll get it.
It's for Office 365.
Yeah.
Microsoft offers a tremendous discount to nonprofit organizations. And I don't have the figure in here, but it is very extremely affordable for nonprofits to go to Microsoft Office.
It's like $3 a user or something.
It's like $250 or something. It's really cheap.
Is user meaning employees or
excuse me?
Karen.
I had a question about the spread of the bids. It seems like they're very, very wide, and mm-hmm. I was just surprised at the difference in the bids. And the one that the lowest one is less than half the other one. I was wondering, is this a reputable company? Why are they doing so much?
Well, we had exactly the same concern, and so we did do a lot of due diligence around checking on other entities that have used Vertex for this exact service, and we had positive results from it. So, I know it's hard to believe, but it's what it is. And it's a reputable company, and it's a reputable service.
Okay. Any other questions? Diane, please take a roll.
Karen?
Yes.
Barbara?
Yes.
Lab?
Yes.
Tim?
Yes.
Carolyn?
No.
Patty?
Yes.
Linda?
Yes.
Okay, so now we have several policy changes, so I need a motion to approve Resolution 16-04 adopting a travel reimbursement policy in accordance with the Local Government Travel Expense Control Act, and to accept accompanying changes to personnel policy 4.14 travel expenses. Do I hear a motion? Barb?
Second.
Karen? Okay, Susan, please tell us about the changes.
Okay, I'm going to suggest everybody turn to page 58 of your board packet so that we can follow along on all these policy changes, because there are quite a few. It could get confusing, but I pulled this first one out because this one there is a new Government Travel Expense Control Act, and we had to make these changes to our policy primarily to cover you when you travel. And the particular things that had to be added to our existing policy were making a list of what were the allowed reimbursable activities, the maximum amount that you would reimburse, not with a dollar figure, but as a sort of general category of things, like you would stay at a conference hotel or something like that. And then it had to include a form, and then it has to be signed off as a resolution. So I took this form, beginning with our policy. There was a form from Ansel Blink's law firm that was on Rails website, and so I looked at that and I combined that into our policy, and then I sent it all to Dennis Walsh at Kleinthorpe, and he revised it. So it's gone through multiple revisions here, but this does include all of the components that it needs to have. So the main things that you need to know are that if you want to travel, you will need to have that approved in open session by a roll call vote. Any of the trustees for any of your travel expenses. This is not for doing a chamber function or something like that. This is for actually traveling to go to a conference or something like that, or a workshop or something. So yours would have to be approved in open session. You can't do any of the things that you wouldn't do anyway, like go to a baseball game and charge that to the library. That's another part of it. You would never have done that.
Doesn't it include employees as well?
And with the employees, the part of it is that if the employees exceed the reasonable expenses, then theirs would have to be voted on as well. That doesn't ever happen. If somebody were to overspend the $50 per diem, say, and want to be reimbursed for it, that would have to be voted on as well.
Okay.
And that is it.
Okay, because I'm reading from the governor's website, and it's all together, employees, officers, and the board. So I don't see where it's separated. So there's a different document that you're referring to?
I refer to the law, but more importantly, the lawyers, two sets of lawyers crafted this document. So I pulled the wording actually from the Ansel Glink form, but Dennis confirmed that it was correct. So
Ansel Glink is
Ansel Glink is the law firm that gave their form to their policy, sample policy to Rails. So I was hoping that would save us a little bit of money to get some of the legal work done up front. But Dennis also has gone through this, made some suggested corrections. So this is Dennis's.
So are these Dennis's corrections? So we don't have, like, underneath all your lined out items, we don't have what the new statute or the new law states?
I did not give you a copy of the law.
Mm-hmm.
But though it sounds like you have it in your hand.
No, I don't. This is actually just a synopsis. So I thought
okay.
When I saw that it wasn't included in this, I thought maybe you have it.
Well, I do have a copy of the law, but, you know, but the lawyers are the ones that made this. So, you know, I just combined it with our existing policy to keep it as consistent as possible. But, you know, Dennis has approved this.
That doesn't make me feel comfortable with everything else that's been going on, but that's fine. Can I get a copy of the specifics from you maybe later on? Can you make a copy for me?
Sure.
Because these are just the main categories. And then I can go through it.
And maybe just suggest, you know, just on Carolyn's behalf, just, you know, check with Dennis, give him a quick call and, you know, 5 minutes.
Check. Well, I mean,
and you can,
he already confirmed this.
This is his opinion.
Yeah.
He says that all the time. So I would just like to see what the law is and what
sure
we've done
that,
with it.
Well, if the staff isn't supposed to be included, then...
Well, I mean, the staff is included. It's on page 62.2, expenses for officials or employees other than members of the Library Board of Trustees, travel, meal, and lodging expenses incurred by any official or employee not covered by paragraph 5.1, member of the Library Board of Trustees, in excess of the GSA rate for meals and restrictions listed above on transportation and lodging, must be approved in an open meeting by a majority roll call vote of the Library Board of Trustees. So it does. And I actually do need this to be passed tonight. This cannot be tabled. Because it goes into effect January 1.
Oh, I thought it was the 17th.
I remember in previous board meetings that we voted and approved of trustee expenses, travel expenses.
That could be, and we certainly, we definitely will have to do that in
okay.
the future.
So,
yeah.
No problem.
Almost seems like it's
yeah.
not a departure from our
no, it's right. It's, and it, you know, it just fleshes out some of the things that you have, you know, said in the past. Did you like, you know, give specifics for rental cars, say, which came up this summer, and we didn't have specific wording for it, so now we do.
Now, it's not to say that the expenses need to be approved beforehand.
It does not have to be
it's
approved beforehand. You just don't have guarantee that they will vote to approve it.
Right. Right.
Yeah.
Right. Yeah, they'll have to vote to reimburse.
So be it. And then, excuse me, is 59 blank? Okay, that's right. I just, that works for me.
That was one with. Diane, please take a roll. Okay, Barb. Barbara?
Yes.
Rob?
Yes.
Tim?
Yes.
Carolyn?
Yes.
Candy?
Yes.
Linda?
Yes.
Karen?
Yes.
Okay, so now we have a set of motion relating to paid time off. First, I need a motion to approve the recommended changes to policy 4.06, which is sick leave.
Mm-hmm.
Karen? Second.
So Susan, can you give us an overview on these personnel policy changes and then tell us about the sick leave policy?
It's 66, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
66, yes.
Just verify.
So we are members of the Management Association, which is an HR association. And one of the services that they offer is to have their labor lawyers review your personnel policies. And so we had that done this year. And so I wanted to pull in particular the paid time off policies out separately so that they could be looked at together and discussed in detail. Because these are, you know, of all of our policies, these are some of the things that affect the lives of employees the most. And, you know, they care about it and they all interreact. So the major changes to these policies are that in the sick leave policy, that is another response to a change in the law. And that part I cannot change. Point one up here, instead of the sick pay only being for the employee, now the sick pay must cover the employee's child, spouse, sibling, parent, mother-in-law, father-in-law, grandchild, grandparent, or step-parent. So I think we can very much anticipate employees using their sick time quite a bit more because there are very many people in the building who have an elderly parent or a child or both. So I think this, our sick time will start being used quite a bit more often. So that was one change that we made to this policy. And that's one that is to keep us in compliance with the law. That change has to stay. So then I also, just looking a little further to go to page 71, the lawyer Jim also made some changes to our vacation allowances policy. He wanted it to be put as a monthly accrual rather than as a yearly accrual because anytime you tell, the Management Association doesn't like it when you give anything to an employee for a year because they feel like that implies to them almost like a contract that you're promising them a year's worth of something. So really, these things all accrue monthly and they want to be spelled out that way. So that was one change that he made. I think that was the only little change to that one. And then on the personal days policy.
Excuse me.
Yes, ma'am.
Excuse me. When somebody made the motion to approve item D, but we're talking about E and F now.
Right, I just wanted to talk about all three of those together and then the motion will, then you'll be voting only on sick pay and then a new motion for each one of the other policies separately. But I bet these all relate and that's why I wanted to explain them together. So then you have a revised version of the personal days policy that's got the yellow highlighted that you got when you came in.
Okay, it's this.
It's in place of page 74. And this one has more significant changes, so I wanted to review it in the light of, oh, I know, there was another change on the vacation one. And that was that he felt strongly on page 71 that we couldn't make our part-time employees wait 3 years to start getting vacation time. He said that's really a problem. So we do change that, so part-time employees will start getting their vacation time right away.
Excuse me, who said that's a problem?
The lawyer from the Management Association, the labor lawyer.
That can be a problem. Some part-time people don't even get vacation.
Well, companies.
I think the only department labor would see it as a problem to make people wake up and get their vacation time. So it's sort of, it becomes a property right as you go along and I think that is a problem, so.
So because we offer it, they shouldn't wait that long, is that what you're saying?
Yeah, right.
He was saying you're basically making them wait 3 years to accrue 1 week of vacation time. And he said that's very problematic. So we've made that change as well. So again, people will be taking more paid time off through that. On the personal days policy, one of the changes that he made is that the way we were doing it before is a personal day wasn't really any different from a vacation day. And he said if you're allowing people to tack it on to their vacation time, if there aren't any rules for how that time is used, then it basically is vacation time. It has to be treated exactly like vacation time, which would mean paying it out if the person left. It would mean allowing them to roll it over along with the vacation time. And so he added this wording, which is personal days may be taken for approved personal reasons, which include personal business that cannot be accomplished outside of the employee's regular working hours, such as banking and legal transactions, home repairs, et cetera. Personal days are not extra vacation days and should not be used as such. So he added that wording to it, which is fine. And I think that a lot of people were taking personal days to cover their doctor appointments and things like that. So the increase in the sick time is actually going to allow them to use their sick time for doctor appointments. I did strike that from the sick time policy. So on page 75, the really significant change that I have made, and I want to be clear that this is my change. This is not, I love to blame Greg for things, but this is not Greg's fault. This is my fault. Page 75. You'll see that I struck out a policy that was added about, a section that was added about 15 years ago, in which people that had worked here for a certain amount of time got extra personal days. So right now, everybody gets 4 personal days, 1 per quarter, basically. They get, once they've worked here for a little while, they get 20 vacation days if they're a librarian, or they get 14, or they get, 15 personal days.
Vacation days.
So, yeah, so vacation days, personal days, they get, and then 12 sick days. So that's what it all adds up to. So then some people were actually getting, in addition to the 4 personal days, they were getting 1 more personal day for 10 years, another one for 15, another one for 20. And it wasn't just that 1 year that you hit the anniversary, it was forever. So that there are people that are now getting like 8 personal days a year. And some of them at hitting the 30 mile mark are actually going to be getting a full additional week of personal time. And I asked Greg to calculate for me how much that would cost us over the next 5 years, because I keep hearing from our departments that they feel like they're short-staffed, and I think it's partly all the paid time off that people are taking, which they are entitled to take because we're giving it to them. And I just feel really strongly that it's become too expensive. And so over the course of the next 5 years, the cost of the people's time of just these additional days would be $85,000. And so I would like to substitute, instead of giving them all of this time off, I would like to create a longevity policy, which comes up next, which is a flat amount of money that they would get on their anniversary date, and then that's it. And that would add up over 5 years to be more like $6,000 if we use the figures that I had suggested.
Can I ask, just for clarification, we talked about personal, vacation, and sick. For someone who's been here 5 years, is that a safe number to pick? What vacation do they get, or how many births, how does that? Well, I'm thinking most of the people in the library have worked for 5 years, right? Most of the people here have been here 5 years, right?
Yeah, I would say
because
so.
Because I'm wondering, where are we talking about calculating all of this?
That is, well, that's on page 71, where there's the monthly accrual rate.
Monthly accrual rate.
And, so and that it's also accrued per year. It's page 71.
So if someone's here 5 years, what are they entitled to?
If they're here and they're a librarian, they are entitled to 4 weeks of vacation time. If they are another kind of worker, they are entitled to 3 weeks, and then after 10 years, they would go up to 4 weeks. So that's either the 15 days of vacation time or the 20 days of vacation time, plus
and
the 12 days of sick
12
time.
Sick days.
Then they get the 4 personal days.
Okay, we don't think that's outrageous. I mean, these days aren't offered everywhere else.
They're not, but that's what they have been getting for all
but
this time.
But we're also now paying for IMRF. Do you think we could all maybe subtract a little bit from our costs?
Yeah, I think the only motion on the table right now is the first one. So
right,
if we could
right. if you
get rid of that,
now,
then you take care of that one and then come back. To
so
the
is that the longevity increase as well?
The only
no,
one on
the
table
right
now,
one that right
is,
now table is the
sick leave.
4.06.
I agree. We should do one at a time.
Yeah,
one at a time.
No, I just wanted to. I wanted to get the overview on the paid time off before we started voting on them. But now I have said my piece. So.
So we're talking about.
Now we're talking about six.
All right. Okay. I would agree that we have to do this now. I had just advised my employer because I do employment work for them. Yes, we have to do this. The law in the state of Illinois has expanded the number of reasons where that you can use sick time with. So So we really don't have any choice about this. We have to let our employees use their sick time for the various reasons which are outlined here for various family members. So I don't think we have a lot of choice about that.
No.
And it goes into effect January 1st.
Yep.
And this is the fourth, this is the one that it can be include other family members.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so is there any place where this below that you should upon separation from employment accumulated sick leave is not payable? This one, however, separation is due to retirement. Like, where does that fit into this? Like into
that is. It's on the, it's the final paragraph here.
Right.
So that they, you know.
Oh, that's still the 4.06, so that's still part of it.
Yeah.
Oh, okay, okay.
Yeah.
I have something in that one. For, okay, with IMRF, it says here that you can accumulate your sick time and get additional service credit. But we cut it, we cap it.
We cap it at 450 hours.
So, so if someone has 456 hours, they're going to take their sick time because they're not, they're going to lose it.
Well,
correct?
A lot of people don't. I mean, I always have 450 hours. I have for years.
I guess my question is, why are we capping it? Why do we cap it? I don't see a reason to cap it. I think that it's a benefit to keep it going. For people who don't use it, I think we should be able to reward them and have it roll back into their pension.
I don't have a problem.
It doesn't really, I'm just trying to ask, it doesn't really cost us anything to do that. I think what it does it, I mean, it would cost us because we would have
yes.
to pay the additional matching
yes.
amount. Oh, yeah.
Wait,
that's why it's usually capped.
There's a question.
Okay.
Does it cost us anything else, Greg?
Yeah.
Well, so if you take 450 hours and you roll it and you use it to buy service credit with IMRF, essentially, you're buying 3 months, depending on where they are on the vesting schedule. If you're past 15 years, each year is worth an additional 2% of your pay at retirement for a pension benefit. So, a quarter percent. I'm sorry. One quarter of that would equal 0.5%. So if you're like a $60,000 a year person, $5,000 a month, you take half a percent of $5,000, I can't do the math fast enough, it's like $25 a month or something like that. And we would have to fund that benefit. That would, you know, that at upon retirement that would go into our unfunded liability.
I'm thinking that, you know, if somebody has been able to accrue 450 hours, we should allow them to accrue as many as they can. Because, you know what, God forbid, you have to have open heart surgery and you're out for 6 months, then you have sick time.
Well, we also have disability plans through IMRF to, you know, to cover those types of things.
Yeah, you could go long-term disability if you're longer. It's a 3 month or something.
Right.
Mention
yeah.
something.
Yeah, go ahead.
I mean, I don't, under the open meetings act, we can really talk about what's on the agenda. I don't know if there's anything on our agenda about talking about changing the sick leave policy from being able to accumulate 400 some to whatever higher one.
Well,
so,
it is to approve the changes to the policy, and I think that you can make amendments to the policy along the way.
I agree with Karen. I think we should approve that we will be in line with this new law as of January 1st, and we should table all these changes and increases or decreases for another time when we can review it more thoroughly. Maybe you can produce costs to us so we have an idea how inflated IMRF might be or how many more times you'll have employees that are here.
That's fine.
So
I just
a little too much
saw it
right
and then
now.
I just,
yeah, and I'm not suggesting a table
no,
anything,
that's okay.
Just this new chapter.
Right, right.
Yes.
Yeah, that's okay. It was just there and I was.
I understand.
Kind of.
Yeah.
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 Okay, all right, no problem.
We could certainly revisit policies at any time. We could do it again in January if you want, because it'd be so much fun in December.
Okay.
Good night.
Are we having fun? All right. So, any other
yeah, go ahead. Okay, are we gonna vote on each one, on 1, 2, 3, and 4 separately? Because I have something to say about 4. And I don't know if this is the time to do, I don't want to.
Yes, right now, we're just doing the sick leave.
All right.
So we're talking about point 4 of the sick leave?
Number 4.
No, number 4.
Under D, number 4.
No, D4, which is personnel longevity.
Yeah.
That's different. Okay, so for right now, it's the sick?
Right.
Okay, Diana, payroll.
Okay, Karen?
Yes.
Yes.
Rob?
Yes.
Tim?
Yes.
I'm sorry, what are we approving?
The sick leave.
To make this up to code for the law.
The uncle, not the uncle.
Yes. Thank you.
Sorry, no. Yes. Okay, so now this next motion is to approve the recommended changes to personnel policy 4.08, vacation allowances. Okay, so that's 2E. Do I have a motion?
So moved.
I mean, D2E. Barb? Do I have a second?
Okay.
Debbie? Okay, so that is a change that the Management Association recommended also?
Yes.
Okay.
All right, and where is D2E? What page?
Page 71.
Thank you.
Okay.
Who made these suggestions, not the state, but some law firm?
The Management Association's labor lawyer, Jim Griffin.
Thanks. All right, so what does the law say we have to do?
Carolyn, I'm not a lawyer. The lawyer looked at this.
I know, but see, we need to be careful because we only want to be in compliance with the state. A labor lawyer has a lot of opinions and he'll help us understand what we can do or what's being done. But I don't know that we're obligated at this point and to rush all this through that we're not sure about anything. I mean, we do that so often here.
I would have to disagree that we're rushing this through. I mean, everybody had this since Friday, could have asked me questions at any time. And most of the changes that are being suggested in the later policies in particular are very minor changes where they just have refined the wording of things to be clearer to the employees. On the vacation policy, he recommended the change that the part-timers not have to wait for their vacation time. He's saying that our policy is a bad one and it needs to be revised. I think it should be revised tonight.
And just, hold on a second. And just, anyway, we still have discussion, we still have a vote. So it's still the board having discussion, still have a vote. So this is recommended changes and we still have our vote.
So I don't think the lawyer was saying that we're absolutely required to do this by law, but this brings us in line with most other businesses and what they're doing in terms of allowing employees to accrue leave on a monthly basis, sort of accrue as you go. We're not giving them any more leave than they already get, but it's just the way that you accrue it. Except that, in addition, the part-time people don't have to wait 3 years to get any vacation.
To receive it or accrue it?
Receive. To take his inventory.
So now, what's going to be, is this vacation we're talking about?
Yes.
So what is going to be vacation for a part-time employee?
It's prorated based on the number of hours that they work.
So
it's at the same level as it's spelled out here,
is it,
but it's prorated.
So part-time is 29 hours, correct?
No, not necessarily. It could be all sorts of hours.
If a person works.
This is what you're talking
yes,
about?
Yes.
If a person works part-time and works, let's say, 17 1/4 hours a week, they get half the accrual that full-time person gets at that.
Okay.
So that's how they would accrue it. We have a lot of people that work 10 hours, 15 hours, 20 hours, you know, and they're accruing at those very rates. We review them periodically to make sure that they're fair. If they're working, you know, if they're working extra hours, we try to make sure they come back in line so they're not outpacing their accrual or underpacing their accrual. Right now, what we're doing is holding all of that for them until they get their 3-year anniversary. So the only difference is that they'll be able to use it sooner, which is a fairer policy, we're not increasing the benefit whatsoever.
So based on our part-timers, what will this cost us?
Zero, because it's not going to hit. We're not changing the accrual.
We're going to need to pay them sooner than 3 years. So as of January 1st, we're going to accrue more expenses, aren't we?
Well, not necessarily. Because, sometimes they save it up for a vacation and they may not have enough for that vacation until 3 years. If they take a few hours here or there, equal to their accrual, I mean, that's up to them.
Okay.
You may advance it, but we're lessening the cost to the outcomes.
It's in the long run. But honestly, I think when we have this type of information before us and we need to make decisions, I would expect that since all of this affects every employee in this library, that you would have all those figures available to us. So we know exactly what we're spending on vacation, sick days and what have you, or what they're allowed to have. So we know what kind of dollars we're talking about. Well, I mean, this is like just guesswork.
I don't think it is guesswork. We have the information. The number of days is right there on page 71.
How many employees
how many people are, what each type of category of employee earns. And it's not really going to cost anything. It's just going to let people take some of their leave a little bit earlier. And I think the Management Association's recommendation, while it might not be absolutely required in law to do this, it is sort of the position of the Illinois Department of Labor that vacation time is a form of payment instead. It's not really cash payments, but it's a benefit.
Right.
And you can't hoard that, keep it from employees, that they are in fact entitled to it as they earn it, as they go along. And so this matches what the Illinois Department of Labor's position has been, and I think that's why the Management Association is recommending that we do that.
And I agree.
So it doesn't really cost us any more, it just allows people to take a few hours off a little bit sooner during the year. And so, I mean, most employers now, I think, are allowing employees to earn leave on an hourly basis. Certainly larger employers do that, and almost all government employers do that. They allow employees to earn it incrementally and take it incrementally, in very small increments. So I think this sort of brings us in line with most larger, particularly government employers.
Well, yeah, government, most probably. But what I'm saying is this packet includes quite a bit, and there are costs associated with this, and it would have been just as easy to provide them to us. So maybe this isn't like an expense that we're going to realize because of vacation. Still, there are other things that we could relate to. And I get it, librarians and department heads. To me, I have no idea what that means. I don't know how many of them there are based on these days or these weeks. What does that mean in dollars? To me, those are important in figures. Because this information doesn't really spell it out. But thank you for that clarification.
Does it really make a difference if we know how many? Because it's still going to have to come out of the pocket anyway, right?
Well, the key is that there's no change
exactly
in the economic
this is
in the economics of the vacation days. There's we're not advancing any more than we are in the old policy.
But if more people take off time sooner, what do you do? Do you have to hire people to take care of what they're doing when they're gone?
Well, we usually have enough flex time in some of the other schedules that they're able to cover it.
Really?
We do have substitutes for some of the departments that, if they can't find people to cover the desk, they may access a substitute for a shift or two, and we budget for that as well. The key is, the key here is if they take it sooner, they can't take it later. So overall, it's going to, reach an equilibrium that's not much different from today.
Tim, Rob, any more discussion?
Not at this point.
No, I think.
Okay, Barbara?
Yes.
Rob?
Yes.
Tim?
Yes.
Carolyn?
Yes.
Patty?
Yes.
Linda, yes. Karen.
Yes. Excuse me, I performed our chair. I have to leave now. Sorry.
Okay, so I'm Karen Diamond, 805. Have a wonderful holiday.
Thank you.
Okay, next is motion F to approve the recommended changes to personnel policy 4.09, personal days. Do I hear a motion?
So moved.
Second. Barb, again. Okay, can you tell us about this one?
This
we changed the wording so that they have to take it for particular reasons, not just to add on to the vacation time. That was at the recommendation of the Management Association. And this is the one where I am recommending the change to stop giving people additional personal days as a longevity award.
Any discussion? We're doing three and four at the same time?
No, I'm just, I have a question. Does this mean, you were saying some people have as many as 8 days, that this cuts them all to four?
Yes, over the course of a year. So they would lose half of them on January 1st, 2017, and the other half on January 1st, 2018.
So it's a gradual.
Linda?
Mm-hmm.
I have an email that was sent to me from one of the librarians I'd like to read.
Okay,
this is regarding the longevity.
Okay, so it's the part.
Yeah. It says,
is that the next one?
Well, somebody said.
Yeah, which one are we voting on?
Personal days. It's so confusing. Why are we jumping around? Let's just do
wait, this
time.
Is longevity pay plan. Oh, the pay handbook. But this is to get rid of the personal days?
Yeah. Right.
And
we're on three yet, right?
Right.
Well, I'm trying to work together.
But they do work together. The longevity plan is
okay.
To substitute for this.
Right. So shall I read this now or
yeah,
wait?
Go ahead.
All right. Okay. I and many of my coworkers here at Niles Library are quite dismayed by the reduction of longevity personal days, which is on this week's board agenda. As someone who will be here for many years next September, I always thought those days were a nice way of honoring my commitment to Niles. The money they are offering in return makes me feel highly undervalued and very unappreciated. By limiting our personal days, they are encouraging us to lie and use sick time for personal issues that come up, which I do not like to do. Also, we do not make tremendously large salaries. I always saw the generous benefits at Niles as a supplement to a higher salary. Mostly, it is about feeling like we have no worth or value here. So many years of my life has been spent here, and yes, I love my job, but it is also important to feel I am worth something to the people around me. If you choose, please make sure the board knows that these proposed changes are not something that all staff is behind. I understand with IMRF coming in, money might be scrutinized more, but this seems like a very small amount of savings in return for jeopardizing employees' morale. No, I'm being honest with you when I say I am most definitely not the only employee who feels this way. Thank you very much.
So can I just say in response, there's no question in my mind that there are going to be staff that are very unhappy about this. People like their time off. I'm losing time off too. Everybody loves their time off. But I don't think $85,000 is a nice way to show appreciation. I think that's tremendously expensive.
Can I ask a question? That's from a librarian, did you say?
Yes.
How much does a librarian make?
There's a range.
What's your low?
I don't have the salary schedule.
I don't think it should be a librarian.
Because they don't make enough money.
Came to me, I feel like.
That's
it's,
fine.
It's my obligation to share the email with
you. Oh, I agree with you. I actually do. I'm just trying to get a handle on, like, does a low librarian make 60 grand? Is that what we're talking about here?
A low librarian would be more like 40. I believe what this person says, she's been here for a long time. I would guess that this person is considerably higher than that.
Okay, well, that's I think for some reason we forget the economy. And there are a lot of people not making this much money. And again, it's the taxpayers in Niles who need to fund this. And like Susan said, it then starts to accumulate your time, and then we've got IMRF involved. So that's why. But if she's considering, I mean, I think it's great working here. I think the benefits are unbelievable. So I know it's hard to lose something.
Mm-hmm.
But still, I think everyone here is so well taken care of.
Do you have any questions?
Well, we have two issues here, right? 3F and 4G there. And 3F, as far as I understand, is that the change on the wording that's on page 75, right? Number two, is that what we're trying to accomplish with that item?
Yeah.
Okay. So I am okay with changing that wording specifically dealing with how personal time is being taken. That seems to be in line with most of what other organizations do. I would like to table 4G, which is that whole discussion on the longevity pay. I'm kind of like, I'm in line with Carolyn here, that I would like to see a breakdown of how many employees are we talking about that are affected by it.
Right, well, I mean, I do have that information, but my problem with tabling it is that these excess days, these extra days are added to the person's account on January 1. So.
Well, then I have to say that I am not prepared to make a decision at this time, fully on this one. And in regards to the cost, that $86,000, that's, and I understand you calculate that based on their salaries and their vacation, but that's not a hard cost. It's kind of more like that's a soft cost. Now, I know I don't have a background in accounting, you know, as some people do, but I believe that's not an actual hard cost necessarily to the library unless we hire somebody out in order to replace them, right? So it is kind of a...
No, it's a hard cost for the most part.
How though? If I take a vacation day, my organization isn't losing any money that they would have
well,
paid.
Well, if you're a circulation clerk, somebody's got to cover that desk, so somebody
right.
else is going to pick up your hours.
Yes, but yeah, other person's being paid anyway.
No.
If it's a part-time person, almost all
then
pension services clerks
then
are part-time people. So somebody else is
how about
actually
full-time,
working
for full-time hours.
Well, it would depend, you know, that's where we bring in the subs
sure.
and things like
sure.
that, and you'll see that the sub line is actually a little over at this point, and it's going to continue to go over. This is why I feel that we have so much paid time off, that this one thing has become, and there just is no other library doing anything similar to this. Most people, when they hit their anniversary, they might get a trinket. They might get a small cash payment. They don't get something that is worth thousands of dollars.
Well, here's an example. Here I say this about it being a soft cost. For example, if Susan's gone, then Greg takes over for her, and if Greg's gone, Susan covers for her.
That is true to some extent, but I don't work a desk. It's the desks where you have to have always be plugging more people in. Plus, I mean, I feel like we hire people to do work. So, you know, we hire them because we need them to do their work. So, you know, she says she doesn't feel valued, but I actually value her work.
I understand that. I wish this had been brought up.
In November?
3 months ago, yeah.
I didn't
I'm
have
feeling
the changes.
Very pressured. Then. You know, this
right.
has to be done by January.
So we knew about this, but we just...
No, I mean, we've known about this for years. This has been going on for 15 years. And I just want to point out that it started because of that... The year that they started it, we weren't giving employees raises. They didn't get any raises. It was before the operating referendum passed. They didn't get raises. They didn't get additional Sunday time. So now they've been getting raises for
very
many years.
Valid point.
But
you.
It's kind of layering things onto each other.
Yeah, she's making a very good point.
And the other thing I can say is I would hate for anybody to... The hard words for me were the undervalued, unappreciated, no worth or value. I would hate for anyone to ever think that of this establishment, and I would hope those words would never cross anyone's lips, because we value everyone very much. The only thing, I'm just looking at from a business standpoint, and I'm trying to be very objective here, is, I mean, at my job, we have to work 187 days. It's like that every single year. I don't care if I'm there 20 years, 30 years, whatever. We have to work 187 days. We don't have longevity. We get, you know, 12 sick days. You get 3 personal days. I mean, that's the same. It's standard. It never changes.
For 20 years.
It never changes because we need you at work. Mm-hmm. We need you at work. We can't run a business if people don't come to work. So we hire you to come to work. I don't know.
Yeah.
What to say? I'm really positive for the giving a little bonus or a little something for thank you so much for your service. We appreciate you so much for your dedication. Thank you so much. I'm not big on giving someone on another day off, but so even though I've only had a few days to look at this,
when looking at it, I'm kind of on board with it. So that's just my position.
And see, I have a slightly lesser position than she does at the same district. And I do get a longevity, very minuscule longevity. You have to be there at least 10 years before you get anything. And then you get it every 5 years after that. So
time off or cash?
Longevity cash.
Okay.
It's minuscule.
It's like a, it's
like, it's like a
you're added to, it's added to your pay, like 50 yeah. cents
yes.
for an hour
yes.
or something.
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah.
Or it could be even less.
It might be even a quarter or something.
But I know
like
that 50 cents means something. I remember seeing it though.
So wait, two people said two different things. You said 50 cents an hour. Is it for
no, it, or, she said it. I well, don't know. It's a small amount.
Yeah, it could be.
Is it a one time or is it like a raise?
I get it once you have 10 years.
Yeah,
because maybe. Once I hit a certain point, the only raises I get, because I'm at that point, is if I get a contractual raise. Where if somebody starts, they keep getting raises until they're at a certain level, which might be for 10, 15 years, because they've changed it. It used to be after 8 years, you stop getting the raises.
Mm-hmm.
Now it's like 15 years. So they get a small raise each time. And they actually changed longevity now. So I think you can't get longevity for us until you're 15 years. But I'm grandfathered, so I get longevity for 10.
Well, what's the nature of that? You said it's a minuscule amount. Is it added to your hourly rate?
It's added to my paycheck.
And your hourly rate.
Hourly rate.
Okay, so it's evergreen. You get it.
Right.
Mm-hmm. You get it every hour after you hit.
Yes. After I hit a certain point. Yes.
So it would be very similar to our current policy.
But we, as far as personal days and that, no, we get 2 personal days a year. That's it. And if we don't use those 2 personal days, they are folded into our sick leave, our sick days.
I guess it just depends on the way you look at it.
Yeah.
It's, but it, each grade has their own different
yeah.
piece. Like the teachers don't, the TAs do.
We
and
do,
each,
and then the safety monitors, the ones at different
level.
But neither of them receive the benefits that the people in this library receive. There's a whole lot more.
Well, it's the
no,
longevity if you get. I have IMR, but that's not what she's talking about. Personal
days,
for longevity.
Right.
We have 2 mm-hmm. personal days. That's it, and so many sick days, and that's it. If you don't use them, then they go into your sick days. In case you have to, for the future. Or if you're going to, at the end, use it towards your retirements, like we mentioned before. It's a total different thing.
Rob, what do you think?
I was a little confused on the highlighted parts. So I see a point three, personal days may not be carried from 1 year to the next. Is that currently?
That is correct.
The same?
Yes. That is.
It, so what can you explain 5 then?
Yeah, the change to 5 is just that when we were initially writing it, we forgot to put in wording to cover the part timers as well as the full timers, because there are part timers who get a prorated personal extra day too.
Okay.
So a full timer at 10 years gets 1 extra personal day.
Oh, so these
a part timer
okay,
gets
sorry.
Prorated extra
okay, so
personal
when
day.
The excess in quotes, that's the,
yeah.
this extra day
yeah.
that we're
mm-hmm.
discussing removing.
Right.
Okay. Okay.
And the gist of paragraph 5 is just, it's all transitional language. So,
okay.
You know,
so it would phase.
If you have 2 extra days, you only get 1 day next year and then the following year.
Here we go. Okay. Okay. That makes sense. Thank you.
Well, 20 vacation days is a goodly amount. And 12 sick days is. How many holidays do we get?
11.
And that doesn't include on the on these days, right? Like
no,
holidays
that's
separate.
Another.
Right.
Okay. No, I there are people that get like 51 days off a year.
Yeah, that's
a
lot.
That's a lot of time. And, I would say that I don't agree with Carolyn exactly that people are extremely well paid here. I mean, librarians as a group are not extremely well paid. They have a master's degree and they don't get great salaries. And getting good
benefits is compensation for that. So there's no question about that part, but I just feel like we went a little crazy 15 years ago. And I just have to point out, it gets more expensive every year as people stay here longer.
I think what happened is, you, 15 years ago, you took care of a void.
Yes.
And then instead of when things came into fruition, that wasn't removed, now it's just all part of the package.
Yep. So now we have to deal with it.
Yes.
People being used to having something that they really liked having, and I certainly understand that.
So could I understand that. I wouldn't mind having that.
I'm not sure how somebody could get 51 days.
When you add up the 20 plus the 12 plus the 11 holidays plus the
eight
paid personal days.
20 plus 12 holidays?
Put 20
plus
26,
sick days.
11 holidays, and eight personal days.
That's
51. Yeah.
It's a tough one.
It is.
I know I'm asking you to do something hard.
You know, it's also hurting the bottom line a little bit there, too.
Well, I just think people are going to be taking more sick time now because of the change to that policy.
Yeah.
So, you know, I'm concerned.
What do you mean they're going to take it?
The sick time has expanded to cover spouses, grandmothers, you know, all these extra
people.
Well,
when they run out of time, then they don't get
paid. Oh, when it's gone, it's gone. But a lot of people don't use their sick time, or not use very much. I mean, they you know, some people are scrupulously honest and they only take it when they're sick.
Pleasure.
Most of us are very tightly honest. Thank you very much.
So we're voting on Susan Egan,
voting
on the sick days. That's why.
Yeah.
On the personal days taken off before, correct?
Uh-oh.
After a year?
Say, limiting it to.
We could just read the sentence before we vote. I'd appreciate it.
Okay.
Sure, the motion.
Yes, thank you.
I get my.
Yeah, because there's been so much said.
Wait,
like,
here it is. Here it is. Approve the recommended changes to the personnel policy 4.09 for personal days.
Which means?
So which is?
Well, if you look at page 75, you can see the changes.
I know, I'm looking at part of it. Can you just tell me what all those blue lines?
The blue lines is what I took out.
And
then added the part about backing the extra days out over the course of the two steps.
Okay, gotcha. That's on the bottom right there.
Correct.
So it's limiting them to four personal days.
It's four personal days.
But just to be clear, the handout with the highlighted sections is what you should be paying most attention to. Because what you received in your packet initially did not cover part-time employees. So we've added language to cover part-time employees on the transitional period.
And this is because it's already into effect. We're just switching the process of giving them their days.
Yeah, so when you make a policy like this, you could make a full, what's called a flash cut, and have all excess days disappear overnight or by the stroke of a pen. Or you can try to ease it, make a soft landing, so that the employees that have 8 days next year will have 6 days, and then they'll have 4 days the following year.
Got it. Okay.
And that's what the intention was of the language
to make it a little less painful.
Well, I guess we could have been thinking of two. I mean, I don't know how vote though, but if in case the vote went to yes, the
well, you know what?
6 days next time, we could always change it back if we didn't want to, and you could make it eight.
Well, keep it at six.
Right, or keep it at six, and then it goes to four. I mean,
if we vote on 408, does that include 409? Because they seem to be
kind of intertwined.
408 was vacation, and you already voted on that. You're doing
409. Right.
But you're talking about the next one, which is the longevity one, which is the new policy to get that, which is 4.24.
I meant 409 and 424 seem to be intertwined.
They are.
I agree. So we can't vote on 409. Unless we consider 424 at the same time.
Is longevity part of our plan now?
Oh, yes.
It's
that was built into the personal days, but now I'm separating it out.
424 doesn't matter. If you approve it, then you have to talk about 420.
Yeah. I mean, if we eliminate one, we should do the other.
What did you say?
I said if we eliminate the one, we should approve the other.
Well.
Right? I don't know. I'm just thinking about, never mind.
We're slowly decreasing the personal days, which eliminates the longevity days. Is that what we're doing, Pfizer's vote? And then at some time in the future, we could certainly review longevity award and.
Well, the 409 is eliminating the longevity days.
In a, not immediately, it's.
Sure, it is. It's 25 years, four additional is struck out.
It's cutting in half.
75.
Yeah, it's cutting in half the first year.
Okay, gotcha.
Okay, is everyone clear? Okay. Diane, please take a roll.
Start from the.
Oh, God, Andrea made me go first.
I know, well, you're the one who bothered. Now she doesn't want to go first. I can't win.
Oh, my God.
See, that's why I don't know if this new way of doing it is so great.
Can you please repeat what we're voting on? 409 is all we're voting on.
409 is taking the personal days from the four going to, well, eight.
No, I understand what it means, but see, that's all we're voting on is 409.
That's all we're voting.
I hate to do this to the librarian who pleaded with me, but I can see the logic in it. I can see the rationale behind the argument for changing it, so I'm going to vote yes.
Okay, Rob?
Yes.
Tim?
Yeah, and given that we've done the IMRF this year, I'm going to have to vote yes on taking away on the personal days.
Carolyn?
Oh, yes.
Patty?
Yes.
Linda?
Yes.
Karen?
You're not undervalued, you're not unappreciated.
Well, if we thought they were, we wouldn't have done the IMRF, would we?
Yeah, it's a big perk. It's a huge, huge perk.
Okay, so the next thing is we also need to approve the new longevity award. Do I hear a motion to approve new personnel policy 4.24 longevity pay plan?
You know what?
Can I, oh, you just, we need a motion, so move.
Barb?
Second.
Any discussion? You know what, at least we can, instead of the nickel in the deck, we can at least give them a stinking plaque like we gave to that little girl who was here with the key to the library. You know, I mean, geez.
Sure.
I mean, I really doubt they'd spend one night out, but a plaque we can have forever, right? That's why I don't want.
That's what I mean, another plaque.
Cash value. Future garage.
Did you get a little star charm at each 5-year increment?
No.
But I really like those plaques with the key to the library, and I thought that was really nice.
So any discussion? Any discussion about the longevity awards?
I have to make a correction. I was combining a couple different things, and I missed a line that I needed to delete on paragraph 2, where it talks about.
Page 77.
On paragraph 2, it says the amount of longevity pay is computed by multiplying the employees. Strike that. It's not done on a percentage basis. It's done by the grid.
Okay.
So that was my mistake. I did not remove some wording that I should have.
Appropriate percentages.
Could we modify this and give them a plaque too in addition to that? I'm serious. Did you say that they get a pin, Susan?
You get a little charm.
It's not a star charm.
Well, it never was. It's just a thing that has always happened.
Okay, well, can we add it on here just to make sure it goes through?
Maybe retirement. We can get retirement.
Yeah. Retirement, yeah.
How about 25 year?
Oh, you mean add the pin on there?
Yeah, make sure that it, you know, we have it in black and white, that we can get the pin as well.
Oh, the pin.
And the key. Looking at this, you would know they get the little pin.
No.
You know, which, it's nice.
So is the plaque at retirement?
Maybe that could be enough.
Let's not get too far. We got a lot to do tonight.
You're not retiring, are you?
I really don't need it to do the library.
That's what I'm saying.
I already gave you a break.
Sold it by grad school, I'm sorry.
Yeah, no, that's true.
All right.
What are you going to do?
Okay, yeah.
Are we, did we get any discussion?
Any more discussion?
Yeah, I just had a question.
Oh, go ahead.
How did you come up with the dollar amount?
You know, I just basically copied off of another library.
Okay.
They were tidy, and I actually should add that, you know, it would go on. If somebody was 30 years, it would be 300, and 35 years, it would be 300.
Just goes up at $50 increments.
Oh, you mean keep on going up?
So it's in step with another library?
Correct.
Okay.
And so this is a one-time award on their anniversary?
Yes.
What you're saying, okay, all right.
And, okay, so I will admit I'm a little confused. Is this completely replacing the external, extra personal days that we just had all that discussion on?
So.
It's cash instead of time.
So in ten years, you get $100, but you don't get that $100 any other time. You just get it to.
And the numbers, I, like I said, I copied off another library, but you guys could change that if you want.
Or we can leave it this way to start with and then change it at a later date.
Is that a cash, so it's taxed?
It's in your picture, right?
Yeah.
So then how would that relate to our, next year you're going to have half the personal days that you have this year, and then the next year you're going to have, that completely gets rid of all that?
Yes.
Yeah.
I mean, no, over, I mean, the one policy stands as it's written now, and then this would be in addition to that.
So in.
So next year.
So in 2018.
2008, yeah.
All the personal days would be gone? All the additional.
Well, the additional, the excess personal days would be gone.
They have to.
But if we're giving longevity cash awards instead of personal days, what happens in 2019 then?
The people that hit 20 years during that year will get their $200.
But they keep those four personal days that they had to go?
Well, the original four.
Those are gone by, yeah, January 1, 2018. So they'd have their four personal days, their normal four personal days, but then as anybody hits a retirement, hits a anniversary, they would get this cash award.
And we get rid of all those personal days, you get all those four.
You've already voted to do that.
The excess.
The longevity days that they were getting.
So full-timers would still have 4 days. They just wouldn't have any more than 4 days in any given.
That's what I'm a little unclear on.
Yeah.
Okay.
But, you know, next year, they'll have half of their excess days as computed this year.
Right. And if you hit 25 years, you would.
Right, so. Right. If it happened to be, you'd have to pay the right.
Is anybody 24 years right now?
Yeah. Right. Okay, so, everyone clear? All right. Diane, please take a roll, starting with Barbara.
Barbara?
Yes.
Bob?
Yes.
Tim?
Yes, if there's going to be a pin.
Carolyn?
Yes.
Patty?
Yes.
Here we go.
Yes.
Yes, if there's a pin.
Yes, okay.
No, I'm sorry.
All right.
Thank you, Patrick.
Now. The rest of the changes to the personnel policies are grouped together. I need a motion to approve recommended minor changes to the personnel policy manual, including the 4.01 personnel policy, 4.02 appointment, 4.03 employment and discipline, 4.04 open door communications, 4.05 absence reporting, 4.07 holidays and closing, 4.10 family medical leave, 4.11 military leave of absence, 4.12 personal leave of absence, 4.13 compassion leave, 4.14 jury duty, 4.15 attendance at professional meetings, 4.18 drug-free and alcohol-free workplace, 4.19 anti-harassment and non-discrimination policy, 4.20 nepotism, 4.21 personnel records policy, 4.22 social media, 4.23 victims economic security and safety act.
Do I hear a motion? Someone other than Barbara?
No.
I'll do it.
I'll take the bullet, Barb.
No.
Do you want to still go first, Barb?
Barb and...
I'll second it then.
Okay. Just trying to help you out there. Okay, Susan, is there anything specific you want to tell us about any of these specifically?
These are all changes, we had them review the entire personnel manual, so this is the remaining policies of it. I did pull out one policy that is the electronic devices or electronic use policy that was literally 10 pages long in its former draft, and I just thought, it's so repetitive, it really needs a lot more work, so I pulled that one out. The other ones of these policies, the kinds of changes that he made would be, as an example, he added alcohol-free to the drug-free workplace. He changed the grievance policy to be the open-door communications policy. He made a lot of changes that are just to make it clear to the employee what their rights are under the law.
Right, I saw some of that.
Yeah, that's mostly what the changes are. And so I didn't think that you needed to scrutinize these one at a time. None of them cost money. I pulled out all of the ones that involved paying money or anything. This one is just the things where to be as clear and compliant as possible, these would be good changes to make.
I have just one comment on 414, jury duty.
Yes.
I believe it says that the employee can keep the check from jury duty, $5 or whatever.
Yeah, $17.
Okay, I've never worked in a place where I was able to keep that money.
But we always have done that. That's not a change.
I'm just saying, but I think that we should let the employees keep that.
Yep.
Yeah.
I think it's.
Yeah, and nobody else give it in.
$17.
Let them double dip it one day.
I don't know.
We do.
Do you?
Yeah.
It's $5.
$17. Okay, any further discussion? Okay, Diane, please take a roll.
Barbara?
Yes.
Rob?
Yes.
Tim?
Yes.
Carolyn?
Yes.
Lori?
Yes.
Linda?
Yes. Okay, any unfinished business? Discussion of the kinds of library history and funding with possible action?
Okay, so you guys had asked me to put this on the agenda for this month. You asked me to make sure with the lawyer to find out the status of the book sale funds. So one thing I did do is I copied the policy. We have a policy on Friends, so just in case you wanted to see that spelled out.
Maybe I should say that if a member of the board wants to make a motion after I make my, after make the report, then we can do so, just so you know. We can make a motion.
Okay.
Yeah.
So you can see from the policy, this the points in the policy are virtually identical to the points made in the Constitution of the Friends. And so you can see that their duties are to represent the mutual interests of the library district and the residents of the communities. To encourage measures mutually beneficial to the library and its residents, focus attention on the library's resources and services, encourage gifts to the library, and maintain an association of people interested in strengthening the library. So that's the role of the Friends. I am supposed to assist the Friends in an advisory capacity. So as far as the book sale money goes, it's custom, but there's no agreement between the library and the Friends to pass that money to the Friends. It's just that they, and currently we've been holding that money until we could discuss this with you. And the amount of money in the fund from book sale money for this past year is $22,000, $22,370. So it's a significant amount of money. The Friends at their last meeting have officially asked that money be transferred to them. So that's partly why we need to talk about it. According to Dennis Walsh, it's really up to the board what you want to do with that money. You could decide to pass part of it to the Friends and let them continue to allocate it to the library for particular things. Some of the things the Friends have funded in the past couple of years have been they bought the statue during the construction project. They have paid money to the schools for to encourage them to develop Battle of the Books teams. They They pay for the Shakespeare Project programs. Those are some things that they have done. They have turned down a number of our requests also. They have decided they don't want to fund anything that isn't directly for the patrons. They don't want to fund anything that's a party. They declined to pay for Linda Weiss's retirement party, so she basically didn't have one. They turned down building the display shelves in the vestibule, in the lobby as you come in, the ones that go around the poles that are three-tiered. I wanted to add those because there were no books in the lobby at all, and people after the construction said, what happened to all your books? And so I wanted to add shelves, and the Friends did not want to buy those.
They declined that?
They declined it. They, well, partly because Chris deals with counters, and he didn't like any of the designs, and he kept turning it back and turning it back and turning it back, and I finally just paid for it out of furniture and fixtures.
Susan, when you said the $20,000, how many months is that? And you said the last year, is it a whole 12 months?
I think it is about a full calendar year.
Okay.
Yeah. So Dennis basically said, it used to be against the law for the library to sell things like the discarded books and like donations and to make money off of that. That's no longer the case.
Is this the time? A long time ago,
but we've been continuing to do it.
Is this the time for me to make a motion to unfriend the Friends?
Wait, what'd you say there?
Is this the time for me to make a motion to unfriend the Friends?
Well, if it's not, I think we always have used them to be a profit,
to
create the profit who are non-for-profit.
Right.
But if we
can, I'm concerned about
but
that.
If we can decide how to use the money ourselves, I don't think we should give it to the Friends.
Well, may I ask a question?
Yes, ma'am.
How are we? Are we still manning this with library staff and none of them?
It is run by library staff and volunteers. It's not a huge onerous thing. It's not like we're spending thousands of dollars generating this.
If we're meaning the library is supplying the staff, and they aren't supplying the people, why in the heck are we giving them the money?
That's right. It doesn't make any sense.
If we don't need them to take this money anymore legally,
we need a statement there.
But if she just said,
if we want to allot them a portion, he called me on the phone. Okay, I was going
to
say, if we wanted to allot them a small portion, that's one thing. But I personally don't think if they're not supplying staff to man this thing, and we are. The majority of the money should go through the library and not through the Friends.
I think all of it should go through the library.
Right.
Well, I'm trying to be a little bit considerate.
Well, in fairness to the Friends, it's not that they just said, we're not going to do this anymore. It's that they are a very small group at this point. So quite a few of them are quite elderly. They really don't have the capacity to be working on it right now. And the library developed procedures to make it go as smoothly as possible. So it just kind of got taken out of their hands gradually over time, particularly when it went to a continuous book sale model instead of the twice annual book sale model. So, it's not that they dumped their responsibilities on the library.
Oh, I'm not saying
so
they dumped.
I just want to be clear that, they're not.
But that's why I'm also saying we don't necessarily have to take it all. We could give them a portion.
Sure, right. And then the other thing I wanted to point out is that the other thing that Dennis told me is that although the money in this fund is still public funds, and it still has to be budgeted, it has to be appropriated, it has to be spent judiciously, it's not taxpayer funds. So it could actually pay for some of the things that you all have been uncomfortable spending taxpayer funds on. And that's where the discussion about doing something for the staff for a Christmas party and things like that, that would be a way to do it without it being using taxpayer
money. So we can actually make line items
Just a couple of things. I asked why Friends has been in charge of the funding for the library, because I don't think it's always been that way, and I was told that somebody else, whatever Chris Anusiak is, president, whoever had his role before, did not actually, he actually just spent money like crazy. That's what I was told. So then I was told that Chris took it over and he wanted everyone to submit requests so he can account for the money. And just in response to your comment, Susan, about they won't approve purchases, they wouldn't buy the shelves, and I was there for those two particular items. They rejected the purchase for the travel books because they asked you to provide them with details. And at that time, you said that your expert person in that department had requested them. And one of the members of the Friends asked, well, how about if you just tell us what's the usage of these 450 books? Because if everyone was of the assumption, people go to the computer before they go to a book. So they really just asked for that information, and I know it caused a lot of tension, and you decided you would just pull your request. And then as far as the shelves go, Hanusiak's concern was something to do with the pointed edges, and he felt for little kids it wasn't safe. So there's a couple of different things going on here, but I think it says here, and I guess this was something that we created as a board. Is this where it says that the Friends is governed by its institute, by its constitution and bylaws, and are responsible for their funds and fund accounting? So we created this, so you're saying we could just change it. Is that what you're saying?
Well, I mean, they have their constitution. I should make clear, the Friends are a separate organization from you, and that's part of what this policy is to lay out, is that the Friends are an independent organization. They have their own board, they have their own funding, and their role is to get gifts to the library, is to, you know, solicit people to donate to the library. So yeah, we could change our policy, but this basically just echoes their constitution anyway. It's trying to keep them in sync.
I guess that's my question. So if in this policy and in their constitution it says they are responsible for their funds and fund accounting, how can we change that?
We're not changing anything except that we're not considering the book sale money to automatically belong to the Friends.
So how do we determine it's not their own funds?
No, what that particular language means is that they employ something called fund accounting, and the fund accounting is built around separate funds in their accounting records.
Right, and those.
So what that language is saying is, basically, it says they're responsible, but what's missing is we're not responsible for doing their accounting or maintaining their funds. So to the extent that they already have a checkbook with or a checking account or a savings account with money in it, we have nothing to do with it. The library has nothing to do with that. That is all their responsibility.
Okay, it's maintaining, but it's not who holds the cash, is what you're saying.
Well, the cash that they hold, they're responsible for. We're not responsible for it.
I'd like to make a motion.
So if it evaporates or if it's spent one way or another, that's beyond our purview.
But we can change who is the holder of the funds.
No, because their funds are their funds. That's what this is saying, is the Friends own their own funds and we can't touch them.
So that money can't be moved from Friends to the library, is that what we're saying now?
We can't take money away from the Friends. The money that Rich reports on every month, that's their money that's already been transferred to them.
Okay.
Any money or their membership dues, things like that, we can't go in there and say, we're going to take your money away.
So what are you proposing?
I have a motion to make.
We're not proposing anything. We can make a motion.
All right, I've got a motion to make. I move, can I do it now? I move that the library maintain a relationship with the Friends of the Library so far as their role is to represent the age, represent the mutual interests of the Niles Public Library District and its residents, B, to encourage and support any measures mutually beneficial to the library and the district's residents, C, to focus public attention on the library's resources and services, D, to encourage gifts to the library, and E, to maintain an association of persons interested in strengthening the library, enhancing its collections, and promoting its use. However, going forward, that the Board of Trustees will decide how the money will be spent.
That's too open. Can't you just say the money pertaining to book sales?
The money from the book sales will be spent.
Well, I think it's confusing.
Yeah, I think once you've transferred it to the Friends, they get to decide what to do with it. What the board has to decide is if they want to transfer that money to the Friends.
So I think.
Well, I'm trying to say we don't want to transfer it.
So you just make a motion not to transfer the $22,310 to the Friends and to.
Going forward.
To decide to how to put it on in our budget.
No, they don't have it.
Well, they don't have it.
No, we have it.
All right, well, then let's not transfer it to them.
So we would have to make a motion to do that, correct? And then decide to, and then we'd have to then figure out how that money was to be spent?
No, or just, you just put it into a fund or into a.
Well, it's not budgeted for this year, so basically it just would have to sit there. And then you would, we would budget for it next year.
What type of fund is it sitting in? Like, it's not in your budget?
It's in your revenue. It's not in.
It is, it's in the budget.
It's in the general fund.
Okay.
So you probably have to.
Then your motion.
Or rescind, you probably have to rescind your motion.
All right, I rescind my motion.
And since nobody seconded it, or.
Have you brought this up?
And maybe if you want to make your motion, what, maybe your motion should be something along the lines of moving to discontinue the practice of transferring monies from the book sale to the Friends, including the amount that's already been accrued on the balance sheet.
Okay, okay. I move to discontinue the practice of transferring money obtained at the book sales over to the Friends of the Library. Including the $27,000 that's already been.
$22,310.
$377.
$22,377. I second.
And personally, I don't have a problem if you decided that you did want to transfer some of that money to them. I mean, they are expecting it. We haven't given them any heads up that they need to start earning.
How much money do they have in there?
It's right around $20,000 as well.
So there's a 20 and a 22,000?
Well, we.
The Friends have their own funds, and that has something like $24,000 in it, I think. I didn't, I wasn't there to get the last treasurer's.
Carolyn, do they provide a budget?
Excuse me, and there's 22 in our general fund?
There's, we've collected $22,000, $22,377 in book sale, and we have not transferred that to them.
All right, I got it.
But they, I would say if there's like $500 and there's, but they have $24,000.
Yes, they've got $27,000.
That's still a lot.
There's no reason to do that.
At their meetings, do they give financial report?
I think Richard does.
Does it seem like there's anything that they have pending that they want to spend?
Yeah, they were, they've already talked about a few things.
But I mean, something big like that?
That's all they consider, though. That's why they were supposed to go to a library in Barrington, because they wanted to get ideas for this library. And since Barrington is one of the libraries everyone seems to think is more advanced or has some things we would be interested in, that's why they could. But it's their plan, so
all right.
I don't know where that, it is right now, though.
You want to take a vote?
All right, yeah. Diane, please take the roll. Barbara?
Yes.
Robert?
Yes.
Tim?
Yes.
Carolyn?
I'm going to have to vote no, because I don't think this is a proper way to do this. We haven't had a discussion with Friends. You know, we meet once a month, and then to just do this and then bring it to their attention, I'm uncomfortable with that. So I'm voting no.
Patty?
Yes.
Linda?
Yes.
In other. So I know that money isn't allocated, so we can't use it for reinstituting or getting staff presents for Christmas or spending part, but maybe in the future. But now we can possibly do that.
Yes.
So let's keep that in mind for next year. Maybe we can bring back staff presents on our staff.
party needs or something. So something to build some community and build some camaraderie and have removed kind of, but we can take that maybe out of the trustee fund?
Yes.
Trustee line?
Oh, no, that's what we did before, and that was a mistake we made.
My understanding is that you could do the, you could do a party out of that because it's for everybody, but you could do individual gifts to staff because that is not a use for the next person. That's what that's.
So you could.
You could do a party because it's treating everybody exactly the same way, but you couldn't give presents. You could give promotional items.
So.
Small promotional items.
And other, could I make a motion to spend like a specific amount of money, like out of the trustee line, like $500 or something, to create a party for the staff for Christmas?
You can't use trustee money for a party.
No, he said you could. It's just, you can't give it. They had a custom of giving Target gift cards at Christmas parties. That's what he said you can't do.
Public entities cannot pay for parties for their employees. They have to get it on their own. You cannot use tax dollars. School districts do not throw parties using their budget money. It's money from other funds.
Okay, so in the future, like late next year, we could use the money from the book sale for a party for the.
Right.
Okay.
So let's look into that for next year. Let's just make sure that we're
yeah,
in compliance.
Right.
Let's look into that. Let's ask the lawyer.
We want to be
we want to be on the up and up, but I do want to build some camaraderie among. And I don't want to say I think.
I think it's important that we should form, do some
and
stuff
help, and to help everyone build that camaraderie.
Yeah.
Anything else?
Any other?
Does Greg have his hand up?
No.
Oh.
Okay. Is that it? Motion to adjourn?
So
say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Thank you, everyone, so much for.